Thank you for introduction from Xiaohua. Particularly, I'm interested in the Belt and Road Initiative is that since about 2 years ago, I attended some of the discussion, particularly in the case of Canada, because in my school and in the school across us in the University of Alberta, they did a little bit research on Belt and Road from the student side, because I keep constantly have MBA students coming to me to ask questions, and they couldn't find a relevant professor in that school interested in this topic. And also I did a presentation about 2 years ago in Toronto, in Ryerson University, with the Toronto Trade Office, talking about Belt and Road Initiative, because in terms of what we heard earlier with several presentations, there are basically four countries publicly talking about they may not be very interested in Belt and Road Initiative. That would be Japan, India, United States, and Canada. Obviously, the reason of China, Canada and US is that we are not on the route of Belt and Road. We are not in the mapping of Belt and Road. But there is a huge business interest from the Canadian perspective. A lot of firms in Canada, particularly in energy firms, which I've been doing research on, resource-based industry, they are really interested in getting into the Belt and Road project. Obviously, they can provide technology, they can provide management know-how, they can provide a lot of expertise in developing along the Belt and Road initiative, but they don't know how to, because there is no government kind of information. Even today, I'm trying to ask about government of Alberta if we can do some more, you know, forum and other things about Belt and Road. The other thing I can see the interest in coming from Canada is because we are a country of a lot of immigrants coming from that area, traditional Central Asia, Eastern Europe. So that's why I also myself interested in the whole topic of Belt and Road. And this particular paper, we did it about 2 years ago, and we are constantly revising it and resubmit to several journals. Obviously, right now we don't have the luck to get into a good journal yet, but we are looking at potential outlets to publish. Is working with two colleagues in Shanghai, one colleague at my own university, and one person in Europe. So our basic research is looking at the relationship between foreign direct investment and institutional quality. And we look at a lot of traditional literature. Basically, there is already testified results. Institutional quality influence FDI inflows. For example, today still US and China, UK are the foremost of FDI receivers in terms of because here we have open economy, freedom, all these kind of things. And on the other hand, there's new discoveries looking at how FDI influence institutional qualities in a certain country. China is a particular case because of the open up of foreign direct investment coming in, and institutional quality keep increasing in different ways. Our specific research question is looking at the second line, and particularly look at Chinese outward investment, how that affects institutional quality in the Belt and Road country. We did some literature review, and what we found is interesting is that there is no consensus here at this general agreement the cost of inward of direct investment and how that affects, for example, in terms of corruption and other institutional quality. And in terms of China's initiative, because all these 64 countries are very different along the Belt and Road mapping, you have some of the most advanced economy like Singapore, you know, some of the countries in Dubai are really rich, and you have the poorest country in the world, particularly in Southeast Asia and in Africa. So once the Chinese firms, particularly under the you know, the promotion from the Chinese government policy going global, they do face a kind of challenges dealing with different kinds of institutional quality, different governments. Sometimes those government changes their leadership. So in case, for example, in Libya, there's a huge Chinese investment in oil and gas industry, and there is a sudden change in terms of their governments. And there is a huge risk also. The other thing is that we look at particularly the literature on institutional quality as a determinant of ODI. And a lot of literature basically give us a kind of insight that we do have to look at how institutional quality obviously already play a role in Chinese investment abroad and in the Belt. The only thing we didn't look at is under the scope of the Belt Road country. So our research question is whether you know, all these investment coming from the China side, either state-owned or private-owned, going to the certain Belt and Road country, improve their institutional quality. For example, some other country definitely there might be very minimum impact, like in Singapore. Their institutional quality is already very high, right? But in certain countries, it might be a different case. So we have we're using WGI database and specifically looking at Belt and Road countries' institutional quality, and they classify into six different categories. For example, corruption, control of corruption, political stability, rule of law, government effectiveness, regulatory quality, and wise and accountability. And obviously, everybody now here, Belt and Road Initiative, I don't want to repeat, but I want to highlight the differences in terms of development in all these 64 more countries. Particularly, you have the highest standard of derivation in terms of investment like Qatar, Singapore, UAE, and you have the poorest region like Afghanistan, Nepal, and Pakistan. First of all, I want to show a little bit on descriptive data, Chinese outward investment into the Belt and Road countries. And you can see that particularly after 2012, after the Belt and Road concept were initiated, in that period, 2012 to 2013, there's a sharp increase of OFDI going to these countries. The other thing is that the interesting we want to look at is China's annual OFDI flows and stock since the establishment of this ODI statistical system. Particularly after early 2000, China overall, as a major provider of foreign investment, is very obvious. The other thing I want to highlight is the proportion of the whole Chinese ODI stock in the Belt and Road country is very unbalanced. For example, almost 25% going to Singapore alone. And you have other countries like Russian Federation, Indonesia, Kazakhstan, Laos, UAE, Myanmar, Pakistan. These are the key major countries receiving Chinese outward investment in the whole geographical area of Belt and Road. Another data I want to show is the trend of ODI into these countries. So we'll see that Chinese ODI stock to host country GDP starting from 40% in terms of, for example, Laos and Mongolia, 32%, which is really high. And also you have, in terms of per capita GDP, obviously I already mentioned ODI goes very huge in terms of huge amount going to Singapore and those kind of countries traditionally have a connection with China, for example, Russia in terms of energy ties. The other thing I want to highlight in terms of data is that economic development, as I mentioned before, of the Belt and Road country are quite different. They, obviously, in terms of population, is huge. The total population of Belt and Road country to the world population is pretty high, over 40%. But the GDP of the Belt and Road country to the world GDP is pretty low. It's only around 10%. So mostly poorer countries. And the GDP per capita is also not that high, around 20 to 40% range. And these are the, I already highlighted the, in terms of absolute numbers, Chinese outward investment in Belt and Road countries in flows and stocks, this is the percentage of overall Chinese investment abroad and particularly Chinese investment in biodegradable country accounts to that number, is not very high. In terms of percentage of flow, is only less than around 7%. So there is a huge improvement space to go for more investment coming from to go into those countries. In terms of stock, is also not very high. It's only around 2%. So mostly, even after the initiative of the Belt and Road concepts, there is not a lot of accounts of stock. So our research, basically we have two hypotheses based looking at the data and also obviously looking at these stock numbers of Chinese ODI in the Belt and Road countries. So we want to look at specifically how why the Chinese ODI improves the institutional quality of Belt and Road, and is there any indicator showing there is a kind of relationship, either positively or negatively? But we suppose there's a positive relationship. The second question is because of a lot of countries in the along the Belt and Road is resource-based country, resource-abundant country. So we want to specifically look at how the Chinese ODI exerts, whether they exert a kind of systematical different impacts on the institutional quality of the country with different natural resource endowments. We suppose there's no systematical impacts because the data shows that China actually at the very beginning interested in acquiring natural resources, but with the improving of ODI projects, a lot of industry in manufacture, in service industry, you know, going to abroad, and they may not play resource-based industry may not only play a big role. So this is our model. I wouldn't go very detailed, but the data coming from WGI, World Governance Index, and we look at specific six categories of country data, corruption, government effectiveness, political stability, regulatory quality, rule of law, and voice and accountability. These are our data source. We also have data from World Development Indicator, UNCED database, and statistical yearbooks of Chinese outward investment. I don't think I need to explain very detail on our model, but we did a difference in the GMS model and test several times. I can show you some of the interesting results here. This is our control variable. Certainly, we put Singapore from the model because Singapore is a country receiving the largest amount of Chinese ODI, 30%, and also is a very much advanced country in terms of institutional quality. So we put Singapore in the whole model, and the results looks very different. So we take Singapore away. And then we also put on some control variables, for example, like GDP per capita, intensity of FDI from countries other than China, and trade openness, basically trade relationship with China, and internet penetration, and natural resource contribution. And this is our result. And it's very interesting, we found some significant correlation between Chinese direct investment intensity related with WGI in terms of average institutional quality improvements. And these are very positive. And in other parts, what we found is that specifically, we found most of the relationships are positive except the voice and accountability, which is shows is not significant. There are several implications and conclusions which I can highlight. The first conclusion from our paper, we found significant positive impacts from Chinese ODI in density to, for example, institutional quality like control of corruption, government effectiveness, political stability, regulatory quality, and the rule of law. All these five indicators. And we didn't find any significant effect for voice and accountability. And which is actually not that surprising because a lot of countries along the Belt and Road initiative, they either have a regime similar like in China, or they might have more like in a way that transition their government. The other result we found is that institutional distance do existing between China and those Belt and Road countries. And most of the Belt and countries, with the exception of those belonging to the European Union, obviously Eastern European countries, in other words, for most of the countries, China might seen as a role model in terms of successful capability at investing abroad. So this is a very interesting phenomenon, and also obviously a lot of discussion might happen on a higher level whether these countries in Central Asia, particularly those belong to the former Soviet Union, or Eastern Europe countries belong to the socialist system before, they are in a way that looking at whether they want to use more Western way of governing their country, or they are more interested in the Chinese way. So they are in the, I can suppose they are in the middle, and maybe they are interested in the Chinese as a role model for them. The other thing we want to highlight is the capacity has very much shaped by a dramatic improvement of institutional framework, except voice and accountability. And according to our model, Chinese outward investment is not only improve institutional quality of the host country in the short term, but we can testify that they also improve in the long term. The last one in our conclusion is that we believe Chinese investment in host country, particularly in the Belt and Road countries, with rich natural resources, actually generates a stronger institutional effect in improving their regulatory quality and rule of law. Particularly these latter results suggest Chinese ODI basically help a little bit on the Belt and Road country minimizing their resource curse. So I think that's basically my presentation. I don't know if you guys want to ask questions right away, or I can wait until this.
Just some clarifying questions.
For sure. Yeah.
If you have any.
So what are the regressors?
Which one?
What are the regressors?
We are using Chinese outward investment in density in each of the country, and using a panel data as experimental independent variable, and only dependent variable will be these WDI indicator, six indicator.
So the independent variables are investment MOFCOM data?
Yes, MOFCOM data. From the statistical yearbook of Chinese ODI. I think that's similar as, it should be the same as MOFCOM.
So how do you deal, for example, mm-hmm. with most of the investment actually goes to tech shelters?
Mm-hmm.
You know, so how do you deal with that? So it almost, if you include the tech shelters,
mm-hmm.
which includes Hong Kong, Luxembourg.
No, actually, we only look at Belt and Road country, 64 of them. Okay. We didn't look at other country.
Look at any
yeah.
of the other ones.
Yeah.
Okay. So yeah. another question I have is,
mm-hmm.
wouldn't investors from badly governed countries have a bad impact? Isn't that, if you look at the theory on political science, mm-hmm. it suggests mm-hmm. that if you have links to authoritarianism, you are probably less likely to democratize?
Yes, yeah. That's actually one of our questions in the paper. We believe, hypothetically we think they increase the institutional quality, but in terms of reality, we don't know. You are right. There might be some phenomenon that looks like the regime was connected.
Yeah.
For example, in Uzbekistan, Kazakhstan, you know, those regimes can connect with the Chinese government, and there's a lot of state-owned company investing over there in the energy industry. This can happen. Yeah. But we didn't count these in a political level. We only look at WGI, their indicator. Yeah.
Maybe another question.
For sure.
By the way, Shehua, since we don't have one presentation, mm-hmm. we can take more time with the two presentations that are here.
We do have two. Second one, and you are here for the third one?
Mm-hmm.
It's Bing Chun, it's my student. No, Salman is not involved in that.
So
we have two
here.
Presentations, so we can have more.
Oh, okay.
Oh.
All right. Yes, please go ahead.
For sure.
Did you take into account all the other investment that went into the
industry? Yeah, we have a control variable. Look at other countries' investment.
Right.
Yeah.
So,
Okay.
I know you said something about treating endogeneity. What exactly did you do? An instrumental variable or just you look at lags?
We are looking at lags, yes. Well, because it's a panel data, so there is a lag over there.
You checked for all the things for serial correlation, etc., and everything is.
We did some.
Itself does not necessarily solve the problem.
We look at the six-fact institutional quality. We look at a composite indicator itself, and also we look at each of these indicators.
No, I'm talking about to establish that it's not reverse causality. That is.
Oh, the reverse we didn't do it. We only do one way.
Because it may very well be that the Chinese the Chinese will invest in countries that are less corrupt or something. So there is some evidence from another country that the Chinese actually did preferred countries that were less more corrupt.
Yeah, well, I think we are not trying to answer the question why they go there, but we are trying to answer the question when they go there, what are the effects?
No, but you don't know that they didn't go there because there was an effect.
Right. I agree with you, because at the very beginning I highlight there are two way of looking at the same issue, because these are two ways, right? Either institutional faculty influence FDI or FDI influence institutional factor.
Can you separate the greenfield and the brownfield investments?
Yeah, that could be a good suggestion. Yeah, because a lot of greenfield investment could come in from energy related industry, like.
And do you control for the industry? If,
we didn't.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's something you should do probably.
For sure.
I just follow up a professor. Did you actually do subgroup analysis? Now, the group of countries which from Central East Asia and Eastern European country versus Western industrialized country. Did you do subgroup
analysis? We didn't do it yet. I agree with you. There should be something like a group. Yeah.
Right. You will say more often.
If you are going to send it to a journal,
you will need to do that.
For sure. And how many groups do you think is the best? Because mostly in Central Asia, South Asia, East.
I think you should think about it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Probably you would not resolve.
Yeah.
You have to look at data, you know.
For sure.
Tell you.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. If you want to specifically ask about the impact of actual investment, using stock data seems a little weird, especially if you look at Belt and Road. Because when you look at stock data, you actually look at the cumulative investment. Direct effect is kind of.
Yes, because our data is from 2006 to 2015. So the Belt Initiative only become a conceptual work in 2013. So if we use the inflow data, that's actually distorted. Basically, we cannot because there's only 2 years data over there after the Belt Initiative become a concept. The other thing is that the inflows, obviously you can look at inflows, but the question is we are not using the absolute number of investment stock. We are using the intensity. As a percent, as a percentage to their GDP, as an intensity. We are not using the absolute number. We're using Chinese outward direct investment intensity data.
Are you controlling for GDP growth then?
We didn't. There is no GDP growth.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I know we have more questions. I did too. So, but we have more for other presentations. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you. Okay.